Good morning, everyone. So the topic I'm given is a breakthrough in genitourinary cancer slide. So the topic I'm going to cover is, next slide, please, on renal cell carcinoma, prostate carcinoma, and bladder carcinoma due to lack of time. Next slide. So if you look at the metastatic renal cell carcinoma, we use the Henk criteria based on the simple clinical factors and risk stratify them into favorable, intermediate, and poor risk and have the treatment selection. And the point to note is 75 to 80% of our patients will be having one or two risk factors, making them intermediate and poor risk. And it's a dynamic stratification, making us change in treatment, including immunotherapy decisions making. Next slide. So based on the Henk criteria, the favorable, intermediate, and poor risk, the outcome vastly differs and helps us in deciding treatment in 2020. Next slide, please. So if you look at the current treatment option for metastatic carcinoma, the RCC is favorable risk with the latest evidence is for axitinib pembrolizumab, that's combo, and then pasopenib and sunitinib other options. And when you look at poor risk disease, IO with ipilimumab, nivolumab is an option, and axitinib pembrolizumab is the second option, both category one. Other option is cabozantinib, and the subsequent lines we will discuss later. Next slide. So if you look at the biological reaction of this combination therapy, which has come up in RCC, is because of the synergism when you use IO with when you use a CTLA-4 blockade in the dendritic cell and tumor microenvironment with IO. Next slide. And if you use VEGF, next slide, please. VEGF PD-L1 inhibition, then also we have the synergistic effect, which leads to improved responses seen in these clinical trials. Next slide. So if you look at the first line therapy, next slide, please, in the favorable risk RCC, the Carmina data, which is long-term results, had come out, which looked at randomizing patients with clear cell RCC who doesn't have brain metastasis to nephrectomy, followed by sunitinib versus sunitinib alone. And the ITT population primary endpoint was overall survival. Next slide. And the trial did not show the non-inferiority and showed that by doing nephrectomy, we are not improving overall survival in the entire population of the patient. Next slide, please. So if you look at So if you look at selecting patients for nephrectomy from a clinic point of view, if your performance status zero and minimal extrarenal disease with a good risk patient, we can look at nephrectomy and it makes sense. But somebody who is in poor performance status with lot of extrarenal disease and a poor risk stratification, nephrectomy does not make sense because it does not improve survival and systemic therapy will do. Next slide, please. So if you look at the frontline RCC recent breakthrough trials, the CheckMate 214, which is the IO, the ipilimumab, nivolumab versus sunitinib, which showed overall survival improvement, and the Keynote 426, which was the Pembro AXI data versus sunitinib, also showed the overall survival benefit. Other options are avelumab, axitinumab, atezolizumab, bevacizumab, and Pembro lenvatinib, which is not yet out, and nivolumab, cabozantinib. Next slide. So if you look at the CheckMate IO214, the IO-IO combination, you can see that the overall survival is definitely improved when they randomize patient of a combination of nivolumab plus ipilimumab versus sunitinib. Next slide. And if you look at by the IMDC risk stratification, this impact was more in the intermediate risk and poor risk, and the overall survival was marginal in the favorable risk stratification. Next slide, please. So if you look at next slide. So if you look at the Keynote 426 in the OF, as far as the PFS and the overall response rate, again, there is a PFS benefit when we use Keynote 426 combo and with hardly any overall survival benefit. Next slide, please. So this was the JAVELIN renal trial, which looked at avelumab, axitinib in the treatment-naive advanced RCC. Again, there is a significant PFS benefit, but no overall survival benefit. Next slide. So coming to the first line therapy for patients with poor risk, next slide, please. When you again look at the combination of the Nivo-EP, it shows a very significant survival benefit. And the Keynote 426 axitinib pembro also shows a significant overall survival benefit. You can see early separation of curves in both, and there is a longer follow-up for us for CheckMate 214. Next slide, please. So if there is there a durable benefit when you are looking at these two therapy comparison, you can see that at two years, like any other IO-IO combination, you have the curves flattening and you have long-term survivors when you use Nivo-EP combination. Axitinib plus pembrolizumab, the data is not yet mature for us to look into that. Next slide. So if you are practically at the clinic and first-line treatment consideration for RCC, you have multiple good systemic therapy options. And in good risk patient, there is and those with favorable intermediate, we don't know what is the right treatment, but you can consider debulking nephrectomy with minimal symptoms and for active surveillance. Patients with poor risk patients, you have two options with the breakthrough data that has come up, either Nivo-EP or Pembro-Axi. So if you're looking at patients with no significant autoimmune disease and you have contraindication for VEGF, including uncontrolled hypertension, and need to avoid chronic VEGF aromatase inhibitor, then you might go in for Nivo-EP. And from looking at the other point of view, if you need a rapid response, you have a lot of disease burden and you want a CR or a good PR, then pembroaxitinib is the way to go. And also in patients where you want to avoid a combination of Nivo-EP related immune-related adverse event. So this is how you choose in the clinic as of now in metastatic RCC. Next slide, please. So the phase 3 trials we need to watch out for. We have patient in metastatic RCC, we have the Len-Pembro versus Len-Everolimus, and also the COSMIC-313 where cabozantinib plus nivolumab plus EP versus Nivo-EP. So you have three drug combinations which we need to watch out for in the first line. And very interestingly, we have in the locally advanced and adjuvant, we have Pembro versus placebo and Nivo plus EP versus placebo to watch out for. Next slide, please. So the subsequent line, how do we take a decision in the clinic? If your disease control is more than 1 year with a single agent VEGF, then you go for another VEGF in the form of cabozantinib. But if your VEGF inhibition has been brief and poor, then you should consider using axitinib plus pembrolizumab or lenvatinib plus everolimus. If no response to first line VEGF, then the drop the VEGF and use IO-IO combination. And if no response to VEGF and IO, then you use a second line VEGF in the form of cabozantinib or axitinib, and that's where the data is, or lenvatinib plus everolimus. Next slide, please. So when you're coming to prostate cancer, we have multiple of options in 2019. You start off with abiraterone enzalutamide, you go on to the newer options of radium-223 or even the lutetium PSMA therapy, which has shown survival benefit in ASCO 2020. And also you look at using chemotherapy, docetaxel, cabazitaxel, and also immunotherapy in some form and secondary hormonal treatment. So this is how the treatment in 2020 has evolved. Next slide. So if you look at, next slide please. So classes of agents varies from immunotherapeutic agent like Pembro, Cipulicil-T, hormonal, abiraterone, enzalutamide, apalutamide, and cytotoxic in the form of docetaxel, cabazitaxel, and the DNA damage, which I mentioned, the lutetium PSMA therapy, which is going to come up in a big way. Next slide. So how do we sequence these agents in the clinic? Again, not fully evidence-based, but we look at symptomatic versus asymptomatic, visceral versus non-visceral, pre versus post-docetaxel, whether docetaxel was used in the adjuvant setting, and the classes of treatment. And also, more importantly, we look at the immune markers and also the androgen receptor splice mutation, that is AV7, which produces resistance to the novel androgen receptor, and also the DNA repair mechanisms, including BRCA. Next slide, please. So if you look at the key terminology, some of the terminologies we need to look at is high volume disease, which is defined by the CHARTERED trial, and also the high risk disease, which is defined by the LATITUDE trial, where there is more than 3 bone lesion, visceral disease, and Gleason score of more than 8, or a high risk disease as per STAMPEDE trial, if you're taking a decision, it should be T3, T4, Gleason score more than 8, and high PSA. Next slide, please. So we have different terminologies in different clinical trial, which we need to be aware of. And also the potential decision-making factors is as cancer-related as well as the patient-related factors. Next slide, please. So the STAMPEDE, they presented the long-term results in ESMO 2020, and you looked at the arm which contained abiraterone versus standard of care. And next slide. They presented the data which showed that there is a significant improvement in overall survival and PFS over the years, and the median PFS was 5.9 versus 3.4 for the abiraterone arm. Next slide, please. So the conclusion was there was significant improvement in the benefit with the use of FFS benefit observed with the androgen abiraterone acetate versus the standard of care. And this was the long-term results that they have published. Next slide. So the genomic alteration of interest in CRPC when we are doing a molecular testing should be AR gene mutation amplification, then the P10 deletion, and of course the DNA repair gene, the BRCA2, which can help us using olaparib, which has also been approved for use in prostate cancer. Next slide. MSI testing again has been shown that this large study showed that out of 1,033 patients, there were 32 patients who were positive. That's the 3.1% positivity rate, and this has helped us use the tissue agnostic approval of pembrolizumab. Next slide. There is again the CDK12 mutation in metastatic CRPC, which is a biallelic CDK12 mutation and lead to gene fusion, which leads to an increased neoantigen expression. And this can be a target for immune checkpoint inhibitors. Next slide, please. So the cabozantinib data plus atezolizumab data was presented in patients with CRPC, which showed significant response rate of 32% in this heavily pretreated patient in ASCO 2020. Next slide. So coming to the breakthroughs in first-line urothelial cancer, next slide, please. So when we look at urothelial cancer, the algorithm is if you are eligible for CIS, then use GemCIS. If you are ineligible for CIS and if PD-L1 positive, then use either GemCarbo or immune therapy. And if it is PD-L1 negative, you use GemCarbo. And the main data initially came up with atezolizumab, where you use SP142, and Pembro, where we use 22C3 as the scoring for CPS and next slide, please. So if you look at the immune checkpoint inhibitors that are licensed, you have atezolizumab, nivolumab, pembrolizumab, durvalumab, and avelumab as per the recent data that was published. Next slide. So this was the initial atezolizumab data, which led to use of atezolizumab in patients who were PD-L1 positive and ineligible for platinum therapy. Next slide, please. And this showed that there was improvement in PFS in the PD-L1 positive subset. Next slide. So the Javelin study was presented in ASCO 2020, which was a maintenance arm after a first-line chemotherapy of avelumab 10 mg per kg, continued till progression, and which showed, next slide please, significant improvement in PFS and overall survival. Next slide please. And this led to avelumab maintenance as one of the standard of care. Next slide please. So the ESMO guidelines has included avelumab as one of the standard of care in the maintenance setting after this data was published. Next slide. So these are the immune checkpoint inhibitors that we are approved for use in urothelial cancer. And next slide. Interestingly, PD-L1 testing is required. Next slide. Is used for patients who are ineligible for cisplatin and who can be considered for carboplatin. We need to check for PD-L1. Next slide, please. Next slide, next slide, next slide, next slide. So the FDA approval for pembrolizumab was in the non-muscle invasive bladder cancer setting, also in the irrespective of the PD-L1. So you don't need PD-L1 for maintenance as well as using in non-muscle invasive, whereas in metastatic requirements in settings, we need PD-L1 testing in urothelial cancer. Next slide, please. Second line urothelial carcinoma, next slide, next slide. So we have use of, again, immunotherapy. Next slide. Pembrolizumab has shown data in recurrent urothelial cancer when it has been not exposed initially and shown survival benefit in KEYNOTE-045. Next slide. So this is the antibody drug conjugate enfortumab. Next slide, which has shown the significant survival benefit in previously treated patients. Next slide, please. The side effects to watch out for is, next slide, please. The rashes, then neuropathy and hyperglycemia. Next slide, please. So we also have use of erdafitinib in FGFR positive patients. Next slide. Which showed survival in heavily pretreated patients also in upfront. Next slide. This is the biomarker-based assay, which looked at biomarker-based testing for in urothelial cancer. Next slide. Which showed that improvement in response rate. Next slide, based on biomarker directed treatment. Next slide. So Pembrolizumab has been used in patients with unresponsive to BCG. Next slide, please. So summarizing, the PD-L1 inhibitors are used in post-platinum setting using PD-L1 testing, and molecular testing should be used to determine for opportunities for targeted therapy in the second-line setting, and this include FGFR2 inhibitor erdafitinib, which has been approved for use in metastatic urothelial carcinoma. Thank you. Thank you for that.